7 stone. Oh, yes, come on. We know holiday weekends can be very busy with family visiting and everything, but you made it. You're here. And for those of you joining us live stream, thank you. You made it, and you're here. And we know this is to say a special Sunday would be an understatement. This is our Sunday of Sundays. I will not equate it to anything like Super Bowl Sunday, no. If you don't know why this Sunday is special, you just stay right where you are and you're going to find out. Today is the day that we say, Lord Jesus, we won. No, come on. We won. We are victorious. I don't know about you, but this wasn't an easy weekend for me. Why? I had to remember Palm Sunday. People laid the palms down. They exonerated, they saluted them. Hosanna, Hosanna, our King. But people are fickle. They celebrated him on Palm Sunday. And he knew that he had to go through to make it to Good Friday. And I ain't gonna give you no Sunday school lesson, but Good Friday was good. It was good for us, but not for him. We wouldn't have resurrection, as some of you call it, Easter Sunday, if our Lord and Savior did not pay a price on Good Friday. So Friday, I took time out. And I looked at a group text that Pastor Carter sends to a group of us. And it put it in perspective how he came to love us. To love us. And the more he loved us, the more the world rejected him. But you know what? Just like you made it today, he made it. Despite all the world did to you, Lord Jesus, you hung on that cross. You gave your blood when the devil and all hell said, G.O., game over, your Savior is dead. They went to a tomb. They rolled a rock away and said, my, a risen Savior truly has risen. Let me say that again. Our Lord, our Savior, your Jesus Christ, my Jesus Christ, Father, your Son has risen. So we have risen. Your Son got out the grave, so we, your children, are victorious. If you never get excited about anything in your life, your Savior who knew no sin paid for all our sins. And I'm happy. I like the way Pastor Carter puts it sometimes. He says, you know, with a comic book, you get it. And if you look to the end, you see, we won. And we did, church. We're victorious. We are a royal priesthood. We are a holy nation. We are a peculiar people. Because of his blood. Because of what he did. Brother Mark, Brother Carey, Bishop. He saw us on Calvary and would not come down. when they said, hey, you, if you're King of Kings and all of that, come on down. Mother Miller, he saw you and Lars. He saw Father Miller, Sister Easter. He saw all of us, Nettie. He saw you, John, Pastor Carter. It's personal. He saw us on Calvary and paid for us, his church. This thing is real. And so this morning, one more time, to you, Lord Savior Jesus, Lord Yeshua HaMashiach, thank you. This body of living stone says amen. We say amen to our Most High God. We say amen. Now, with all hearts still, you in your own sanctuary, let's go in prayer and let's give thanks. Father, we thank you that you created man. But our first father, Adam, and Mother Eve, they fell short in the garden. But Lord, you most wise and sovereign God, you had a plan. You had a plan, and that plan was simply in a name, Jesus Christ. And you came, and you, the Word, dwelt among us. You, the Word, walked with simple men and gave them knowledge of your kingdom. You took a Simon and made him a Peter and said, in this rock, the gates of hell will not prevail. And before you left us, you said, I have to go and prepare a place for you, that where I go, you might also be there too. And you gave us, oh, Father Yahweh, your very own Holy Spirit that keeps us, that comforts us, that teaches us, that shows us all things. And Lord Jesus, before you left us, you said, ha, I no longer call you servant, but I call you friend. Because I've made all things known to you that the Father made known unto me. Now, Lord, we ask, have your way. We are your children, the sheep of your pasture. We ask that you touch yonder shepherd over this, your house, your servant Rodney Rivers. We're thankful for the legacy of our Bishop Henry Wyatt Hearns. But Lord, this morning, we are excited and we are yearning and we are looking for you to do a new thing, for you to do a greater thing, for you to touch every household, Lord. And we ask, whatever might be on any mind right now, your peace be still. Yes, Lord. We say, yes, Lord, come, touch, abide, reign, Lord. Take us over. Make us what you created us. Make us your new creation. And now, Lord, just continue in this service and remind every heart, we celebrate today your resurrection, but we have your victory every day we wake up with blood running warm in our veins. And as long as we call on your name believing, we're going to stay sealed in your most holy and high victory. And in that name that's above all names, we say amen. In the name of Jesus Christ, we say amen. In the name of Jesus Christ, we say amen and amen. Thank you. It truly is a blessing. You may take your seats as I continue with our announcements. But we take a lot of things for granted. All our modern day amenities, cars and homes. Yesterday, several hundred of us on the west side had a wake-up call. Power was out from 12 noon Saturday, and it didn't come back on till sometime this morning. So if some of us look a little tired, it was a long night. I mean, some of y'all grew up in the country where you knew there was no light. Yeah, I see you over there smiling, Bishop, unless that moon shined. Well, let me tell you, if you did not have solar lighting around your house, thank Lord I did. It was a very dark night. And you could hear everything when it's dark because normally you don't be paying attention to everything. But God is able and God has provided, amen? And we are here. We are here. And so many didn't make it from last Easter. But we are here. Thank you, Lord. Continuing with our Sunday announcements. Oh, I'm sorry. I keep on forgetting. It's Youth Sunday. Hey!
Good morning. My name is Caitlin Lawrence. Do we have any first-time visitors? And if so, please stand. Great, we all are family. I want to welcome you to Youth Sunday morning services. Sit back, relax, or join in with us as we praise and worship our Lord and Savior. Thank you.
Good morning, Livingstone. My name is Samaya Gray. And today I will be reading Psalms 34.
Hang on a sec. Please stand.
Please stand. I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. My soul shall make its boast in the Lord. The humble shall hear of it and be glad. O magnify the Lord with me. And let us exalt his name together.
Amen. Very good. Say thank you.
Thank you.
Good morning.
Oh, yikes. My name is Sanaya Gordon, and I'm going to be doing the announcements today. So we have a spring walk slash Zumba. And it's a woman-to-woman ministry. The woman-to-woman ministry is holding their annual spring walk slash Zumba. It will be a time of lots of fun. So save the dates for Saturday, April 6th, April 13th, and April 20th from 9 a.m. to 10 a.m. Come out and enjoy the early morning serenity breeze. And if you have any questions, the point of contact is Minister Linda Patterson or Sister Brenda Tate. There are also flyers in the lobby. We also have Bible study every Wednesday evening from 7 to 8 p.m. in the small sanctuary. We have a memorial service for Brother Roy McCullough, Saturday, April 13th at 10 a.m. right here at Livingstone. And special announcements and videos are the Woman to Woman National History Month announcement, the Youth Achievement Certificate presentation, and the Youth Day report and video. Thank you.
Very good.
Y'all give them a hand. They were a bit nervous, but they did a great job. Let's give them a hand and encourage our youth. Also, we have youth Bible study on Wednesdays. That wasn't an announcement, so I'm going to put this plug in. We have youth Bible study on Wednesday from 7 to 8 in the education building. And I also want to let any parent, grandparent, auntie, uncle know that if you have a child 5 to 8 or 9, you could bring them as well, and we'll take them across the room because they need to learn about the Lord as well. Thank you.
Amen. One additional announcement. We know many of you we may not see often, but we want to make sure for the Shepherd's Ministry that we have contact slips for you to update your information. So if any of your information, your cell phone, your home phone, your email address, if any of that has changed, the ushers, they do have the envelopes. If you fill that out, could you turn that in for your elder at the end of service? And you will get an email from me acknowledging that I have received it and updated it so the Shepherd's Ministry can be in contact with every family. Amen? Amen. So are we ready? Oh, hold on. Hold on, I'm sorry. Sister Barnes has an announcement.
Happy Resurrection Sunday. Aren't we so glad that he lives, that he rose with all power in his hands? Amen. Today is the last Sunday of Women's History Month, and throughout this month here at Livingstone, we have managed to acknowledge women here in our ministry and out of our ministry. So we have a few more to go. Is that okay with you? Amen. I would like to first off acknowledge, I'm not sure if we did this month, but Pastor and First Lady Rivers, they have a niece by the name of Juju Watkins, and she is a phenomenal basketball player, and her team has just made it, I think it's called, now I'm Sports Challenge, to the Sweet Eight, is that right? The Elite Eight. Okay, almost had it. So they just made it from March Madness to the Elite Eight. So we want to acknowledge Juju Watkins, who's the niece of our pastor and first lady. We would like to acknowledge a few ladies from last Sunday. We had a woman-to-woman mixer last Sunday, and I believe that the ladies were blessed. And there are some ladies that always are there to serve us, and I would like to take the time to acknowledge them today. Anytime I call them, especially in the last 6 months, that there's been a funeral or some reason that we've had to have food, they've been there. Now, there were some ladies who were at the fellowship that did not register, that just came on that day, who did not get your certificate after church. If you would meet myself, I will be over here where I usually sit with your certificates if you did not receive your certificate last week at the mixer. Amen. But the ladies that we're going to acknowledge today, they work in our usher ministry, and they are a part of our hospitality ministry here at Livingstone. So I am going to call to the front to receive a certificate and let them know that we honor them, we love them for all of their service and for always being there for us in that capacity. So without further ado, Sister Patricia Graham, Sister Lola McWilliams, Sister Charlotte Weber, Sister Mildred Blue, Sister Paula Young, and Sister Cynthia Dilworth. I have certificates for you. So these ladies are ushers, but they're also a part of the hospitality. And whenever we call them, they come and they're helping to serve food and clean the kitchen. And we just want to say thank you and happy Women's History Month to you. You are essential. Amen. We have two more to go. I would like Mother Virginia Jo Miller to stand. We are acknowledging her today, not only for being our church mother, but for being the wife of the late Pastor Jerry Miller, amen? Amen. And also being the current owner of Carroll Manor Retirement Home right here in Sun Village, California. We honor you, amen. And I'd like to acknowledge in her absence, elect Lady Lisa Carter, amen, who is our assistant pastor's wife. She works in healthcare services, healthcare administration, if you will. We love her, we honor her, and we do have a small token of love for her in her absence. We love you. All of you women here are essential. What did you say, Pastor? You said it last week. It wouldn't be a, say it. It's a man's world, but what? Say it. God bless you all. And I believe we're where we need to be. It's time that we're getting ready to have some praise and worship. Amen. We're getting ready. Uh-oh. We have a video. We're going to take two. If you can have a seat.
Give Minister Renata Barnes a big hand, and we thank you so much. Good morning, Livingstone, and good morning those that are streaming in, and good morning, Mrs. Anderson. I'm Mark Anderson, and I'm a member of the Dynamic Youth Ministry Team for Livingstone, and I want to recognize my lovely wife, Sandy Anderson, who is also a member of the team. And what we did several months ago, some parents may remember this, we were encouraging you to give us the names of your child and let us know, you know, what they've done that is worthy of achievement in school. And I'm so happy that some of you responded. And what we'd like to do is recognize some of your children and our superstars. So, as I call your name, come on up real quick, if you don't mind. So, Caitlin Lawrence is recognized for the Principal's Honor Roll and Student of the Month for March. So, come on down. Yes. Wow, and she did a beautiful job with the welcome. Congratulations. And just stay up. We're going to have a picture taken. Next is Kenny K.J. Lawrence. Come on down. Yes, he's being honored for the Principal's Honor Roll. Yes, look at him in his nice suit. Always looking sharp, K.J. Candler Price. Candler Price is being recognized. Come on down. Principal's Honor Roll with academic achievement, 3.5 to 3.9 GPA. And the Student of the Month for teamwork. There you go, Chandler. Congratulations. That's a lot. Callie Lee. Where's Callie this morning? She's being recognized for the Principal's Honor Roll and the Attendance Award. She may be in a little bit later. Yes. Tierra Scott. Is Tierra Scott here? She's being recognized for honor roll with academic achievement, a 3.5 GPA. Let's give Tierra a hand. Recognize our young people, the future of our church. Samaya Gray, she's here today, recognized for the honor roll. Yes, she did Psalms 34, 1 to 3. Samaya Gray. Thank you, Samaya. Congratulations. Keep up the good work. Samantha Gray, is she here? Oh, wow. 4.6 GPA, straight A's, history making and bringing part of the girls' soccer team, winning for the first time ever, and that was, what's the name of that school? Quartz Hill High School, yes. So let's give her a hand. Boy, she is dynamic. So these are our winners for this Youth Sunday. Young people, doing good things. So congratulations. All right. And one more thing, real quick. I want to talk about another event that the youth ministry team has brought to our church. And we thank everybody that's been working on the team. I believe we'll have a video, as Ms. Barnes had mentioned, about the video coming before we do our praise and worship. But Youth Day, we've done three of them. Youth Day is a regular event. It's an experience, actually. It was developed by one of our active members of the Youth Ministry Committee, Tamika Williams. And during this Youth Day, we have the video shown, we have the word that's brought. We had our Youth Day yesterday, and our own pastor, Carolyn Cooks, brought the word. Lots of discussion that goes on. Thank you, Carolyn Cooks. I know you're streaming in this morning. We thank you for spending time with our young people. We have arts and crafts. We have food. We just have a really good time. So what we'd like to do, we'd like to have Leilani Polona come on up and talk about, she was there yesterday, what that experience meant to her. So let's give her a hand. Leilani?
I learned what the true meaning of praise and worship is. Praise means lifting God up, and worship means when we give our deepest affection and highest praise to something. At Youth Day, we learned what praise and worship meant, and we also got in a circle and read a few lyrics of a gospel song. We also made up a dance to the song we read and performed it. And we also had lunch, and at the end, we did karaoke.
Thank you. Thank you, Leilani. Okay, thank you. Let's give her a hand. It's really tough being up here. Speaking in front of people is very difficult. So we're going to have another Youth Day, about three or four throughout the year. We encourage you to bring your young, your kids, ages 12 to 19, and we just have a wonderful time. So thank you, and I'll turn it over to our elder.
To all of our youth, we are proud of you. You often hear that they are our future. They are. And to all the families, the parents and grandparents, it takes a village. That's the return on our investment. That's us, okay? That's going to be this pulpit 20 years from now. And we have to keep them in close prayer. Oh, I'm sorry. It's an announcement with you. Okay. Just one brief thing I would like to say to keep them all, from those that were here to First Lady Rivers' niece, Juju Watson. I don't know if you know, but I watched some of the top sport commentators, and they said this young woman, to be a freshman, which meant last year she was in high school, they said she is one of the greatest sports leaders we have right now. They're not talking about college. They're talking about out of all sports, because of her humility and her heart. That's what we need as black people. That's what we need for our youth. So please keep our youth in prayer. Mark and Sandy, let's give them a hand. Thank you very much. Renata?
Amen. Immediately following service, as we dismiss,
Sister Ruth and some other members of the church have a special treat for all of our babies that are here today. So you can pick up. Now, when I say babies, we have candy and stuff. So you guys wait. But they have candy bags and treat bags for all of the babies that are here today. And so you can, as you're walking out in the foyer, they will give your young person something. Now, if there's any left, Deacon Mark, we'll give you a bag.
Now, we both were a little rambunctious, but guess what? It is that
time.
Time
to praise.
Are you time
amen.
To
Hallelujah.
Praise and worship?
Amen. If everybody would rest on their feet, amen, and begin to clap your hands, amen. Begin to just give God your own glory, just to begin to tell him, thank you, Lord. I love you, Lord. I thank you for your power, God, your dunamis power, God. Hallelujah. It is time that we can all participate in praising our Father. Hallelujah. Glory to your name, God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Let's get rammed up in the spirit. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Our very own worship leader, our senior worship leader, Mother Linda Evangelist, Mother Linda Boland. Amen.
He's alive today. He's alive. He's alive. He rose from the grave and he's alive today. Come on, church. Get excited, for our God is alive. Amen.
Hero,
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 hero.
walk and I can't run, but I can walk. Come on, Vanessa. Come on. Everybody just clap, 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 clap. Yeah, hero, hero, hero from the dead. Come on, hero, hero, hero. The Lord. I love you guys. I love the people of God. I love it when we worship together. I love that. Corporate worship. That's a powerful thing. It's powerful, saints. It's powerful. It's powerful. You ought to put your hands together right now and know that it's powerful when we come together and worship. My hallelujah belongs to him. My hallelujah belongs to him. Praise the Lord. My hallelujah belongs to you. 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 Oh, you deserve it. You deserve it. You deserve it. You deserve it. Everybody, my hallelujah.
My hallelujah belongs to you.
Come on, let's worship the Lord. Let's worship the Lord.
My hallelujah belongs to you.
Oh, glory, 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 glory.
My hallelujah belongs to you.
Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah.
My hallelujah belongs to you.
You deserve it, you deserve it.
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 Oh,
all the glory.
Come on, real quiet. Can we whisper some love into his ear? And just lift up our voices and let's just worship him right now, saints. Lift him up. For he said, if I be lifted up from the earth, I'll draw all men unto me. If I be lifted up, so let's lift him up, lift him up, lift him up, church, right now. Lift up your voice like a trumpet. Give him some glory. Give him some honor that's due. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, Lord. Hallelujah, hallelujah. That's it, that's it, that's it. That's it. Yes, 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 yes. Yes. That's it, that's it. God bless you. And the people of God said, amen. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. We're going up a little higher. We have the young people coming forth. Amen. Come on, let's clap for our young people. Amen.
Yes, yes. Come on, come on. Keep on praising.
Hallelujah.
Keep on praising. A note on that. That's personal. Did you know what you were telling her? My. That's personal. My hallelujah belongs to you.
Yes.
It didn't matter what the person next to you was doing. My hallelujah. Do you know what hallelujah means? It means praise God. Yes. So you were saying my praise, yes, my worship belongs to you.
Amen.
I'm not going to mention her name. No, I will. One time I saw my beloved sister Sylvia Garner, and she was singing it with tears in her eyes. And I knew what life had dealt a hand to her and what she had been through. And I saw her walking the aisles just going, my bishop, hallelujah. That's it, Sister Linda. My hallelujah belongs to you. And he's hearing you.
Amen.
And it's a sweet fragrance.
Amen.
Unto him.
Amen.
He don't want any type of worship, church. He wants something personal. It's a father-daughter, father-son thing. It's personal. What he did on Calvary was personal,
hallelujah,
so that we could have a my hallelujah.
Yes.
Church is personal. So why don't we make it that? Amen.
Amen.
We're going to continue with our offering. If any of you would like to give in the sanctuary and do not have an envelope, just raise your hand and ushers will get one to you. Of course, we have several ways of giving. We can give electronically through Zelle and PayPal. We can give through the standard U.S. mail. And then if you just feel blessed to come to the campus and bless the campus, say hello to our administrator, say hello to pastor, you can drop it off in person. But for now, I'm going to let the ushers come, and we're going to collect our offering. And I want you to just take the time. Now, you can't pay him for everything he's done. We ain't going to go there. But if he's been very good to you, try to show a little in return. And how many of you know you can't beat our God-given no matter how hard you try? And I ain't going to go into that betting thing. I'm just going to go try it and see if he's not true to his word. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. You are now in the hands of the ushers.
God raised him up.
Yes, he did.
He got up.
Thank you, Lord.
God raised him up. He got up.
He got up.
God raised him up.
God raised him up.
He got up.
He got up.
God raised him up.
God raised him up.
He got up.
He got up.
So I'm here today.
He got up.
He got up.
He got up.
God raised him 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 up.
He got up.
He got up.
Stand as we bless the offering. Father, we truly thank you for every heart that had it to give, Lord. And those that did not have it to give today, Lord, the heart that wanted to give, touch so that they can give in the very near future. Now, Lord, what we've given is of your own. And we ask that you touch and you show us how to take this, your tithe, in your offering to increase your kingdom down here. In that name that's above every name,
yes, Lord.
We bless it in the name of Jesus Christ. We say amen,
amen,
amen, amen. And amen. Yes.
God raise him up. God raise him up.
Don't you know he got up?
God raise him up.
Surely he got up. For you, he got up.
He got up.
For me, he got up.
He got up.
Wouldn't stay down. He got up.
He got up.
Surely enough, he got up.
He got up.
End of the story, got up.
He got up.
Don't you know he got up? Don't you know he got up? All power in his hands up. The right hand side got up.
God raised him up.
Why don't you tell?
God raised him up.
Why don't you tell?
God raised him up.
Why don't you tell? Don't you know?
He got up.
All power
in his hands.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Okay, we're going to continue with our service.
suffering and shame. And I love that old cross where the dearest and best for a world of lost sinners was slain. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown. That my Savior lives, because He lives, I can face tomorrow, because He lives. All fear is gone. forever he lives.
Lord.
Sometimes life is hard. Life hits and you go through it. And for those who don't know the Lord, they might ask the question, why do you keep going to church? Why do you keep praying? Why do you keep worshiping? The song says life is worth the living, just because he lives. Today represents everything that, all the reasons that we come, all the reasons that we pray and we raise our kids up and we teach them. This today represents all of that. In spite of what everyone else is saying about their multiple gods or their multiple ways to go, there's only one way. There's only one God. Jesus made that clear. He says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father but by me. And so, yes, the Christianity is a dogmatic faith because we claim that there is only one way because Jesus said there is only one way. And so we worship the way, the truth, and the life. Life is worth the living because he lives. Praise God for that beautiful demonstration and it's ministry is what it's called. It was ministry, and it opened up our minds and our hearts, and as we remembered why we're here. If you have your Bibles, turn with me to
Matthew chapter 27. And as you're turning, I'd like to acknowledge Bishop Henry Hearns is in the house. Looking young as usual. Matthew chapter 27, beginning at verse 50. Matthew chapter 27, beginning at verse 50. And it reads, Jesus, when he had cried again with a loud voice, yielded up the ghost. And behold, the veil of the temple was rent in twain from top to the bottom, and the earth did quake, and the rocks rent, and the graves were opened, and many bodies of the saints which slept arose, and came out of the graves after his resurrection, and went into the holy city, and appeared unto many. Like to speak on the subject, it's not what it looks like. It's not what it looks like. You may be seated. This day has been challenged throughout history, from the atheists to those that worship other gods, Buddha, Muhammad, and the thousands of other religions. This day has been challenged because we say, he rose. Of course, you would believe that the Romans would deny this, but it was a Roman centurion soldier who said, surely this was the Son of God. But of all the non-believers, the Pharisees, the chief priests, and the religious leaders, the loudest naysayers of the resurrection were the religious leaders. Those that taught about his coming were the ones who missed him. Those that were teaching and bringing all the news about the Messiah would come, they missed him when he was here. Which makes me believe that we can come to church and still miss him. We can sing in the choir and still miss him. We can serve on all the different auxiliaries and yet still miss the Messiah. Because if you're coming for the wrong reason, he'll walk right by you. Others are shouting and you're looking and wondering, what are they shouting about? Well, they had an encounter. They had an encounter with the risen Savior. John hadn't yet written John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish but have. Somebody been reading. When I think about what took place, that God gave his only begotten Son, of all our children, I cannot give up one. I'm selfish like that because they're my loved ones. They're my babies, and they're all grown, but they're still my babies. And if I had to sacrifice just one, if I had to be honest with you, I couldn't do it. But God gave his only Son. And didn't give it for those that loved him, but for those that hated him. And ultimately for those that would take him to Calvary's cross. Three things I like to bring out in this text before I take my seat there. The death of Jesus, the destruction of the temple, and the despair of the people. It says, Jesus cried out with a loud voice and yielded up his spirit. Death is final. Anyone who's had loved ones that you have lost, the finality of that death, it hits and it hits hard. Within a few days of your loved one passing, several things have to take place. You have to go and receive the death certificate. You have to to go down to the funeral home and make arrangements. You have to go to the gravesite and make arrangements. You don't even have time to mourn, because several things must take place, and the finality of that loss has not yet hit you until you have the celebration of life service. And the body is laying right here. You're sitting on the front row, and it hits you. This is the last time that I'll see my father, my mother, my brother, my sister. Jesus has, he's gone through it. They have beat him. They have stripped him. He is bleeding. If you look at him, for those that knew him, he was hard to recognize because he did not resemble the same man that they knew. That's how bad they beat him. For 3 years, he had a tremendous impact on the lives of everybody he came in contact with. Oh, I can hear people starting to talk about him as he hung on the cross. I remember I heard that he fed 5,000. That didn't even include the women and children. I heard that he turned water, he turned wine into water at a wedding. I heard that he healed a man with the withered hand, simply told him to stretch out his hand. Oh, but did you hear that he raised Lazarus from the dead? I know the woman at the well would tell you her story as people are gathered around on this horrific day, sharing testimonies as they're remembering the impact that Jesus had on their lives and how he changed their lives. There was a man who was crippled for 38 years. Jesus said, take up your bed and walk. Everybody he came in contact with, he had an impact on their life. And the difference between Jesus and the religious leaders pointed out everybody had issues. And nobody was worthy to come into their presence. Nobody was like them because they were the righteous one. But Jesus, he stood down and began to talk to the ordinary people. He would sit down and eat with just sinners. And that irritated the religious leaders. He calls himself a teacher and look at him hanging out with sinners. Well, if you ever get to the point in your life that you can't talk to sinners, then you missed it. How can you share your testimony if you only share with people in church? You need to go to the liquor store sometime and share what Jesus has done for you. Let them know that you used to have a bottle in your hand, but he delivered you from that. If we don't share our testimonies, then what's the point of it all? Jesus told them before he raised Lazarus from the dead. He says, I am the resurrection and the life. Jesus told his disciples, let not your hearts be troubled. You believe in God? Believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it was not so, I would have told you, I go to prepare a place for you, that where I am, there you may be also. Now, they're looking up to Jesus as he's on the cross bleeding. Hands are nailed to the cross, feet nailed to the cross. A crown of thorns has been embedded into his head, and he's bleeding profusely. He can't even take his hands to wipe away the blood because they're nailed to the cross. And the people are looking up, wondering what's going on. This is a horrific story. And you can't dress it up. Recently, there's a very large church that made this statement as it relates to Easter Sunday and their invite to all of their guests. They say this, and I quote, for us, the most important thing on Easter is inviting people to church. This means reaching people far from God. So we're not going to use words like Calvary, resurrection, or the phrase the blood of Jesus, for we won't use language that will immediately make someone feel like an outsider. This statement came from the Elevation Church. Can I say to you, yes, this is offensive. Yes, it's horrific. It's terrifying. But this is the essence of the gospel. This is his passion. This is the story of salvation, of the salvation of mankind. Without this story, without the blood and without the death, there is no resurrection. And without the resurrection of Jesus, there is no salvation for mankind. We always have to remember to tell this story. We got to remember what it looks like, what it felt like. We can't dress this up and make it sound because somebody might get offended. Yes, mankind should be offended. Because he died for our sins. You should never forget. I'll never forget my father. I have a picture of my father. It's a hat on my bookshelf with this picture on it and with the words that said, "Always remember Dad." When we take our communion, it is always remembering the blood sacrifice and the body that was broken for you and for me. No, we can't dress it up. We can't make it sound good. We can't make it look good. There was nothing good about the cross. He looked horrible. He was beaten beyond recognition. He bled over and over again. No, we can't make that look like Hollywood. It was the day that our Savior died for our sins. We always got to go back down memory lane. The late Minnie Riperton sung a song years ago, "Back Down Memory Lane." That's what Easter is all about. We go back down memory lane as we remember what he did for us. And so I challenge you, don't worry about offending somebody. Tell the story. Jesus says, "This is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Go back down memory lane. Don't just show up on Sunday morning, on Easter Sunday morning, dressed nicely, but forget to tell the story. Oh, it's okay for you to hide eggs for your kids, but tell them about the story. It's okay for families to gather with a big Easter celebration and have dinner, but don't forget to tell the story. Don't forget to go back down memory lane. They're looking up at Jesus, and they hear the words, "Bishop, my God, why hast thou forsaken me?" And they're thinking, "I thought he was the one. And now he's on the cross. He's dying." And 100% of the people that was ever put on the cross, all of them died. And so as he's up there dying, their hopes are dying. They're in disbelief. They feel like they have been abandoned. "I thought he was the one to deliver us. And here he is on the cross, dying." Can you imagine what was going through the minds of the people that he touched? Mary. The disciples are scared to death. They're scared to even raise their hands. And they're saying, "I thought he was the one." Can you imagine what that felt like? Here's a man that came and he healed. Oh, he took some fish and some bread, and the Bible said he fed thousands. He healed the dead. They came and told him that your friend Lazarus was sick. And the sickness is bad. But the Bible tells us that Jesus hung out a few more days. And then when he finally got there, Mary ran to him, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died." And he says, "Take me where they have put him." I need y'all to understand, he waited on purpose. The Creator already knew what he was going to do, but he needed everybody to know who he was. He said, I am the resurrection and the life. You got to not miss the significance of the word, I am. When Moses says, when I get there and talk to the Pharaoh, who should I tell him sent me? He said, tell him that I am. And so I am sent. And he's there. He said, take me where you have laid his body. And he gets there and he begins to cry. And he's looking out at the people and he says, remove the stone. Lord, wait. I don't know if you've heard, but he's been dead 4 days now. The cup has set in. There's an odor in his body that will leak out if we move the stone out. Lord, it's too late, but it ain't what it looked like. Lord, it's too late, he says it ain't. Remove the stone. I know to you he's dead, but to me he's just sleeping. It ain't what it looks like. I know to you his body has been destroyed, but I'm the creator of his body. In the beginning, God created man and gave them life and breathed into him the breath of life. It ain't what it looks like because I am the one that gave him. I gave him the tissues in his body. I gave him the muscles in his body. I gave him the heart that is beating. It stopped, but it's waiting for me to call it its beat again. Nevertheless, Lord, they moved the large stone away. On that great and glorious day when the rapture happens, every saint will hear their name. He said, then the dead in Christ will rise first, then those which will remain alive will be caught up to meet him in the clouds together. He says, Lazarus, come forth. Y'all got to remember, he's been dead 4 days. The heart has already stopped. The body has been, the body doesn't even resemble, it started to tear apart. He's been wrapped in grave clothes, and all of a sudden they see and they hear some movement in the grave. Lazarus stands up, and he says this final word to them, loose him and let him go. Why? Because it ain't what it looks like. You thought he was dead, but God said, I was waiting that I may be glorified in this moment. They're looking at Jesus, and they're horrified. The hearts have been broken because I thought he was the Messiah. I thought he was the one. It says, and behold, the temple, the curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. The earth shook and the rocks split. The temple. This is what happens when God is not involved. The high priest, they began to alienate the people. Only certain people were worthy to come in. This beautiful edifice was built in 2005. Bishop designed it. But let me be so bold, he didn't design it that only certain people can come in here. He didn't design it for all those who grew up in church could come in here. It wasn't designed for those that look like us can come in here. But the people of this day did not have the same luxury we're going in. In fact, talk about going into the presence of God, into the Holy of Holies. Only once a year could the high priest go in, and that was the Day of Atonement. He would go in, he would prepare, after he had prayed for the sins of the world and the sins of his own, he was prepared to go into the very Holy of Holies. This was the presence of God. There was three curtains, and the first one was in the outer courts. The second one was just before the Holy of Holies. And finally, it was that final curtain. His heart begins to pound because he did not take it lightly, because I'm going into the very presence of God himself. And I've got to make sure I got it right, because if there's sin in my life, he would not escape. In fact, they were so horrified, if the priest died in there, they would tie a rope around his leg. Because if he died, then they would pull him out. They would not be bold enough to go in and retrieve him. But once a year, he would go in and he would pray. The bell, although it was beautiful, it was not to be the object of admonition, but it represented the separation of man and God. This happened in the Garden of Eden when Adam sinned against God's word. Everyone after Adam was born into sin. For all have sinned and come short the glory of God. Can I say that one more time? All have sinned. Sometimes we get a little self-righteous because we go to church, but we got to go back down memory lane and remember when we were sinners. Remember when we were doing what we were doing. Truth be told, some of us are still doing what we're doing. The high priest on the Day of Atonement would go and offer up the sacrifices for the nation. God instructed Aaron to cast lots on two goats. One would fall on the goat for the sacrifice, and the other one would become the scapegoat, which represented the nation of Israel. Each year, this was repeated over and over. 1,000 times, this has been repeated. And finally, God says, the hour has come, the time has come for the ultimate sacrifice, the Lamb of God. John said, I saw him coming. He said, look, behold, the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sins of. He saw him coming, and the Spirit of God in him had to speak out. He said, the Lamb of God. This was rehearsed over and over again. And now here he is. He's dying. Every time he would take a breath, it would cause excruciating pain. In fact, he could not breathe. He had to try to lift himself up to get enough air to breathe, to be able to say the words, I thirst, and it is finished. And it baffles me, Bishop, how someone who has been abused to this point would still utter the words, Father, forgive them. But they don't know what they're doing. All of the pain it took for him to be able to say those words. Thousands were coming. Many looking up. There's always different people who come to church. There are those who come to worship. And then there are those who come to fellowship and gossip. There was no difference at Calvary's cross. There were many people that were there. Some were in disbelief because Jesus had impacted their lives, and they were crying, they were hurting, they didn't know what they were going to do. And then it was the religious leaders who were still saying, let him die. And there were those that were saying, I told you he was just a man. There's always the different people that go to church. Oh, if you could be a fly on the wall and could hear the conversations and to see the text messages that are going through, even while service is going on, it would be appalling that they call themselves believers. Pilate says, I have examined this man, and like all of the criminals in the past, when I find them guilty, there's no hesitation that they should go to the cross. But this man, I find no fault in him. And so back and forth, until finally the cry came so loud, crucify him, that Pilate gave in. He's taken that long walk with the cross on his shoulders. He's been beaten so bad, it's hard for him to hold the weight of the cross. But the weight of our sins was heavier. A couple of years ago, my cousin tragically had a house fire. And in this fire, she was burned. So they called me, and I ran and drove down to AV Hospital, and they said, we have to transfer her because we don't have the capability of the specialist to be able to handle what she's going through. So they airlifted her to a hospital in Riverside. And then they called me and said, we have conducted the necessary tests. Two different departments conducted the same test, and they came with the same conclusion. They said she is brain dead. They said, but one thing we have discovered, that she was an organ donor. And so my sister drove out on the day that they were supposed to have the operation. And what she did, she FaceTimed me and my brother as they were getting ready to take her from her room to the operating room because she was an organ donor. And what they did fascinated me, and I'm on the phone watching, tears in my eyes, my sister is crying, and we're watching this, and every member of the staff stood up as they rolled her body past them, and they call this the walk of honor. And everyone stood still until she passed by on the way to the operating room because she had donated her tissues. Somebody might have life, even though she's about to lose her life. Well, on that great day that Jesus was walking on Golgotha, I believe the heavenly host was lined up on the outside on the walk of honor, saying, hail to the King, hail to Jesus, because without his organ donating, without him giving up his life, all of us would live and die. It was the walk of honor, the walk that saved my life and your life. He donated his life. Woo. In order for me to live, in order for you to live, a sacrifice had to be done. it's not what it looks like. They watched him walk down that road with the cross, bleeding and unable to stand. But if heavenly hosts could tell you, it ain't what it looks like, because he's going to live. He's on the cross. All hope seems lost. Looks like Satan has won. But I'm careful when I say it ain't what it looks like. Some people look at you and look at what you're going through, and they make the misdiagnosis that she ain't gonna make it. he ain't gonna make it out of this one. But if you could listen to their faith, if you could hear what God is saying, that it ain't what it looks like. They look broken, but they're stronger than it looks like, because in their weakness, God says, I make them strong. So when you see that mother come up to the altar and she looks weak, God says, it ain't what it looks like. I'm building something on her. I'm building her up on the inside, because I have donated much to her cause. It looks horrible when they give you the pink slip on your job. But God says it ain't what it looks like. It looks bad when the doctor gives you a bad report, but God says it ain't what it looks like. I'm the one that caused Lazarus to come out after being dead 4 days. It says he cried with a loud voice and released his spirit. And at that moment, there was an earthquake. When the earth shook, the curtain in the temple was rent from top to bottom. And the temple represented separation between God and man, and only once a year would the high priest be able to go in it. So what does this mean? God says all are now welcome. No longer do I need the once a year sacrifice. Now the ultimate sacrifice has come. The ultimate organ donor has come. The ultimate blood sacrifice has happened. Now that whoever would come, God says the doors are now open. Come unto me, all ye that are laboring, heavy laden, and I'll give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart, and you shall find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy, and my burdens are light. Tradition has it that when Jesus cried out with a loud voice, the high priest was preparing the evening sacrifice within the inner curtain. Two lambs were represented that night. It was the lamb in the temple, and it was the lamb on the cross. After Jesus breathed his last, the temple shook and the curtain was rent. And tradition has it that this lamb that was in the temple ran out because he was now the scapegoat, because they already had the ultimate sacrifice. He was on the cross. Many ran in disbelief. Many felt like orphans now because he's breathed his last. They've taken him down from the cross and they have wrapped him in grave clothes. They have put him in a borrowed tomb. And the finality of death, they've sealed the tomb with a large stone. But it ain't what it looks like. So Friday night, it looked like Satan had won. It looked like all the devil and his angels were celebrating. All of the religious leaders had a party going on, but it ain't what it looks like. Saturday night, it looks like it was all good. Everything was wonderful. Everybody was celebrating, and the people of God were still mourning. But can I tell you, it ain't what it looks like. Because there was another earthquake that happened early Sunday morning. Matthew 28 says, now after the Sabbath, towards the dawn of the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to the tomb. And behold, there was a great earthquake. For the angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came down and rolled back the stone and sat on it. His appearance was like lightning and his clothes white as snow. And for fear of him, the guards trembled and became like dead men. But the angel said to the woman, do not be afraid. It ain't what it looks like. For I know that you see Jesus whom was crucified. He is not here. Listen, he has risen. As he said, come see the place where he lay. Well, church, it ain't what it looks like. And sometimes we go through hell and high water, but tell your haters, it ain't what it looks like. Tell them that he lives. Tell them about the resurrection. Don't be afraid to talk about Calvary. Talk about the blood. Talk about the death, but oh, don't forget about the resurrection. So when I hear churches say we don't want to offend nobody, so we're not going to mention Calvary. We're not going to mention the blood of Jesus. Because we don't want the outsiders to feel like they're outsiders. Well, if they're non-believers, then they are outsiders. We cannot be ashamed of the gospel. We've got to tell the story. So I challenge y'all today as I close to go back down memory lane. Don't let this Easter be about eggs and gatherings, but tell the story about the resurrection. Tell the story about the death. Tell the story about Calvary. Take your family back down memory lane. On a hill, far away, stood an old rugged cross, the emblem of suffering and shame. And I love that old cross for the dearest and best. For a world of lost sinners was slain. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. I'll cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown. Stand to your feet. To the world, it looks like we're doomed. But to the believer, we can tell them it ain't what it looks like. Because I know a man. It looks like despair is all around us. Oh, I am horrified to think about somebody, and I won't mention the name, but somebody would take the Holy Word, sell it to cover up their sins. You can sell it for $100 or $60, but it will not. The Bible is the Holy Word of God. You can't extort it. Oh, but one day, every one of us will be held accountable for what they've done. Old folks say, the Bible says, you reap what you sow. Well, trust me, one day he will reap it. You can't keep exploiting God for your personal gain. How do you sell the word to cover up rape? If I could tell them face to face, I can say it ain't what it looks like. You can't play God. You can't play church. You can't. Because he sees all and he knows all. And so here we are today on this Resurrection Sunday. We're here because there's a story to be told. And our story cannot just be told on Easter Resurrection Sunday, but it has to be told on Monday, on Tuesday, on Wednesday. Tell it on your job. Tell it in your neighborhood. But most important, don't forget to tell it to your children. Tell them about the story of Jesus. Let them know that this is not an easy story. It's not a beautiful story, but it is a necessary story. Because of what he's done, you have the right to the tree of life. Because of this blood sacrifice. I go to prepare a place for you, that where I am, there you may be also. Oh, I can't wait to get to that place, because I believe that there is a door with my name written right on it. And I don't know if it's a mansion, but I do know the room is large enough for me. And on that door, it has my name. And if you are a born-again believer, he's got your name written on your door from the moment you were conceived. He says, I go to prepare a place for you. What did that mean? He said, I'm going to Calvary to be the ultimate sacrifice. So I've got to shed my blood, and I've got to give my life. He said in the garden, Father, if it is possible to let this cup pass from me, that's the man. But God says, well, nevertheless, not my will, but your will be done. From the first garden, man fell. In the garden of Gethsemane, God says, I'm about to make it right. And he takes that honor walk. Because he's about to donate his body for mankind. If there's anybody here right now, you've been in church before, but if you have to be honest, you've never taken that commitment step. You never made that commitment to go to the next level. That is to accept him as Lord and Savior. There is only one way to heaven. We can never back down from that. We can never alter that. We can never change that. Jesus says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man goes to the Father but by me. That is the only way. So if you're ready to accept that way, the way, and say, I want to accept Jesus as Lord and Savior of my life, I'm ready to make that exchange, because let me tell you, we don't talk about hell. We love to talk about heaven, but can I tell you, hell exists and heaven exists. But hell was created for the devil and his angels. It wasn't even made for you. And I hear people say all the time, well, how can such a lovely God send people to hell? God sends nobody to hell. We send ourselves to hell by the decisions we make or not make. So if you make a decision today that you want to go to heaven, well, he's got your name written on your door. If you're here today and you want to make that decision for Christ, that you might absolutely become a born-again child of God. That does not mean you're going to be perfect, because none of us in here are perfect. I don't care how long we've been in church, none of us are perfect, even right now. But if you're ready to make that decision, would you just raise your hand and say, pray for me. I want to be saved. I want to be saved. Hallelujah. If there's anyone in here who said, I'm looking for a church home, a place where I can call home and where I can grow and learn and fellowship, I just need a place to call home again. If that's you, would you just raise your hand? Raise your hand. Well, amen, amen. Everyone seated, everyone is seated. Talk about going down memory lane. That's what communion is all about. If there's anyone here who did not receive a communion cup when you came in, would you just raise your hand? I see hands already. All right. Keep your hands up and they'll come right to you. I don't. Right there, Elder. Right in front, Bishop. One in the back there. One in the back. Anybody we miss? Do we miss anybody? Right there in front. For I have received of the Lord, which also I delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, the night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Let us eat together. And after the same manner, he also took the cup. When he had supped, saying, this cup is the New Testament in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you do show the Lord's death until he comes. Let us drink together. Amen. Everyone standing. Yes, sir. Go ahead, Bishop. Go ahead.
This young man here, I'd like to see him out for your opinion. Which of you all would be asking if any of you all had your children go to school at the charter school that we had going? This is Brother Paul, and he was our math teacher. Like what was it?
Good morning.
It's wonderful to be in this again. My journey is something that we've been.
Ah, that's right. Yeah. 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 Right, he's right behind you. Amen.
Thank you.
Amen. Well, enjoy the rest of your Easter / Resurrection Sunday. Celebrate. But remember to go back down memory lane. Don't ever forget what we're here for. Now to him that is able to keep you from falling and to present you faultless before his presence of his glory with exceeding joy, to the only wise God, our Savior, be glory, majesty, dominion, and power both now and forever. Amen. You may be seated. Don't forget outside there are some treats for our young kids. There are some treats for our young ones. Not the old ones. Good to see you. I got it. Sunday. Next week is first Sunday. Hey, girl, what's going on? How you doing? Yeah. God bless you. Take your time. Yeah, just take your time. Don't rush.